Once again, another cult classic action adventure was chosen for this show. But unlike Beyond Good and Evil and Shadow Man, this one's cult wasn't big enough for it to warrant a sequel. Not all Overlook works seem to be equally lucky, it seems, but nevertheless we shall inspect this triple-A title, Enslaved, Odyssey to the West.
While the game's creative director is Tamim Antoniades, with development directing coming from Nina Christensen, both would later bring forth Hellblade Senua's Sacrifice, it also had significant writing output from none other than filmmaker Alex Garland of 28 Days Later and Ex Machina fame. He's not the only big name they managed to attract to this project, as the player character is performed by film star Andy Serkis, and I'll later talk more about how he just disappears into the role. Anyway, this easily aggravated brute of a man is only known as Monkey, and he's living in 150 years into the future where the humankind has decreased in numbers due to a war in the past. He's been captured by mysterious slave traders, but not for long thanks to a young tech-savvy lassie Tripitaka, or Trip for short, played by Lin Shishaw, who ensures this is the second game in this show that starts with a plane accident. And that's pretty much all the characters for the majority of Enslaved's length. Well, there's Trip's lovably crude family friend Bixie, played by Richard Ridings, but he is introduced during the last third, so I won't talk about him much.
If the name of the characters feel to be somewhat on the nose, that's because the story is loosely based on a 1592 literature classic Journey to the West, often credited to Wu Qiang, and this is, can also be seen from the gigantic robot bosses that I think resemble beasts found from the book. I've never read the novel, but even I could recognize when the writing tried to be so smart by taking an element from the literature classic and adapting it in modern setting. Essentially, Enslaved is one of those cases where the writers try to experiment on how loyal they can be to the source material without being loyal to the source material.
During the high-octane escape sequence, which is the first of 14 chapters, the game shows its age with its linear level design. To be fair, it offers some wiggle room later, but most of the time traversing is going through narrow tubes while performing preset acrobatics. Nevertheless, Monkey and Trip crash on land, but Trip, who needs some extra muscle, puts a slave collar on him and promises to remove it if he helps her back to her home village safely. Thus begins their journey together, and the development of their chemistry adds to its enjoyability. At the start, certain rockiness can be noticed.
Do you think you could tell me what the plan?
To get you home as fast as possible so that you can take this thing off my head and I can break your neck. Yeah, I know what you meant.
But eventually when Monkey starts to mellow out Trip's optimism and determination, why he doesn't move to the next ledge? I'm trying to press, but it still doesn't... God damn these controls! This is not even 90 minutes into the game and I'm so ready to just quit and not review it at all. With slippery movements and way big turns that make such precision-based activities like walking through minefields and aiming at shore, it's evident that the game was designed with console gamers in mind.
For the record, all Ubisoft-published Prince of Persia games recommended me to use controller in their installation screens, yet I never had any trouble with mouse and keyboard. So... over 15 years after acquiring this with the sands of time, it was time to break a lifelong tradition and play a PC game with a controller. Except not because this older model isn't supported by Windows 10, so back to square one!
Eventually, because of either restarting, hitting the hidden event trigger, or higher powers taking a pity on me, I managed to move forward. Though, now that I think of it, perhaps it wasn't just a control-related issue, as the game's code is shaky all over the place. Like this moment where Trip started to hack a door system and it took me a few minutes before realizing she's never going to finish her hacking and having to load the previous checkpoint. And this 2013 PC port is supposed to be premium edition. That being said, game-breaking bugs aren't that frequent and its combat and presentation makes you forget them quickly. Visuals have aged gracefully, the last post-apocalyptic world is gorgeous, and characters have been animated lively, especially their facial expressions are top-notch. As I mentioned before, the dialogue writing between the traveling companions, while not reaching the sense of time's astronomical spheres, is believable, and following the melding of Mangi's rough exterior is satisfying. For Mr. Sergensen's top-tier performance gives weight to his every word.
Has anyone ever killed one of these before?
Not that I know of.
Oh, you did it!
Yeah. The truth is, we did it.
But what will be action-adventure without action? And there's plenty of that as well, because the landscape is filled with old war-era robots that are in hibernation, waiting to be activated by the slightest sign of movement. The combat is that more advanced version of Pure and Good and Evil's rather simplified system, and there's plenty of skill points to share to develop your attributes. Whenever the system overall is better or worse is dependent on how tolerant you are towards its escort mission elements.
Monkey's slave collar is indeed linked to Trip's heartbeat, so if she dies, so does he. Despite her excruciating physical weakness, Trip isn't completely helpless in battles, as by using her mad hacking gadgetry, she can project holograms to distract enemy fire and other miscellaneous bits. But keeping her alive can be tough when mixed with the control scheme that is so jerky. My first playthrough attempt stopped at this fight because I couldn't move the cannon fast enough to save Trip, and half of it went in the menu by trying to adjust mouse sensitivity setting. I did pull through for this review, but I have no scientific proof was the helpfulness of setting twisting caused by placebo effect or not. Despite that, the combat is decently entertaining. The game does its hardest to make you feel it's flashier than it actually is, with sparks and intense finishing moves, and for most part its smoke and mirror tricks work.
And that's how the game continues towards semi-cliffhanger ending. That is anticlimactic, but nothing hugely unsatisfying. Enslaved, Odyssey to the West isn't the smoothest action-adventure there is, but its positive elements are numerous enough that it makes me think that it deserved more.
The game is partially a prisoner of its time due to the non-flexible controls and linearity, but akin to its player character, there's labor of love showing through the rough exterior. While the writing can get smug when haphazardly referencing its ancient source material, the strong main pair feel real and the pacing of different gameplay types is balanced. So yeah, a fairly enjoyable experience when the code stops throwing hissy fits.
While the game never got a proper sequel, it did receive a small downloadable expansion, Pixie's Perfect 10, that follows Pixie's adventures before the main events, but I didn't bother with it. Next time I shall take a look at a prequel sequel to an action role-playing game that I've reviewed before. Until then, thanks for your time. I'll stop the rain for you.